Heyo! So unfortunately, this month's video, which is going to be on Cardcaptor Sakura, is taking longer to edit than I initially anticipated because it's turning out to be just under an hour-long video and it's going to take approximately another week to finish. But that being said, I really don't like missing deadlines and I didn't want to leave y'all with nothing this month, so I wanted to make something I could quickly whip up instead. So since I love audiobooks and y'all seem to really enjoy the Kiki's Delivery Service video, I thought it might be fun to read the first couple of chapters of Kiki's Delivery Service aloud. However, I can only read a little bit on YouTube for legal reasons because it's a bit of a sticky area when it comes to fair use. And that being said, if you like this video, I strongly encourage you to buy the book for yourself, and there is an official audiobook version on Audible read by a professional and not just some rando. Hashtag not sponsored, hashtag could be sponsored. So yeah, here we go. The beginning of the story. Once, there was a little town sandwiched between a deep forest and gentle grassy hills. The town was built on an easy southward slope, its roofs the color of dark slices of toast all in a row. Clustered in the center of town near the train station were the town hall, the police station, the fire station, and the school. It was a normal town, one you could find anywhere. But if you paid close attention, you'd find things you wouldn't usually see. For instance, silver bells hung from the tops of tall trees. Even when it wasn't storming, these bells sometimes made a racket with their ringing. Then the townspeople would turn to each other and smile, saying, "Little Kiki must have gotten caught again." But how could someone so little ring the bells in the treetops? Well, if you looked to the east and peeked into Kiki's home, you'd find the answer. On a gate pillar facing the road hung a sign that read, "Sneeze Medicine," right next to a big green gate that sat wide open. Beyond the gate was a large garden and a single-story house. The garden grew herbs in a neat row with broad leaves and pointy leaves, all different kinds, and a pungent scent filled the area. The smell continued into the house and was strongest around the copper pot in the kitchen. From there, you'd have a perfect view of the front living room wall. Instead of paintings or family photographs, as you'd expect, two brooms made of bundled branches hung there, a big one and a little one. And from the living room, you could hear a family's voices as they gathered for tea. "Kiki, when are you planning to leave?" said a woman's voice, full of disapproval. "I think it's about time you let us know. You can't keep putting it off like this." "That again?" a girl spoke now, somewhat annoyed. "Don't worry, Mom. I'm your daughter, after all. I am a witch. I'm thinking about it."
"How about leaving it up to Kiki, dear?" a calm man interjected. "Until she decides for herself, you can prod all you want, but it won't make a difference."
"Yes, you might be right." The woman's voice rose slightly. "I'm just anxious. I feel responsible, you know." In this house lived a family of witches. Well, Kokiri the mother came from a long line of witches, and Okino the father was human. As a folklorist, he studied legends and tales about spirits and magic. Kiki was their only child, soon to turn 13. The three were talking over tea about Kiki's coming-of-age day. When daughters of witches and humans reached the age of 10, they decided whether to follow tradition and live as witches themselves. If a girl picked this path, she promptly learned her mother's magic and chose a full moon night of her 13th year as her coming-of-age day. For a young witch, this meant leaving her parents' house and moving to live on her own in a town or village in need of magic. Of course, finding a witchless town on her own is a difficult thing for a little girl to do. But over the years, witches' powers had grown weaker and their numbers had dropped. Such important traditions helped them survive as well as share the existence of witches with as many towns, villages, and people as possible. At age 10, Kiki had decided to become a witch and learn Kokiri's magic right away. Kokiri had two magic abilities. The first was growing herbs to make sneeze medicine, and the second was flying through the sky on a broom. Kiki quickly got the hang of flying, but as she grew older, she often found herself distracted by all sorts of things. For example, the big pimples that started appearing on the sides of her nose, or deciding which dress she should wear to her friend's birthday party. Whenever that happened, her broom would suddenly start to fall. One time, she was so busy thinking about the scratchy new underwear she was wearing that she ran into a power line. Her broom broke into pieces, and Kiki herself ended up with bumps on her nose and both kneecaps. Soon after, Kokiri tied bells to the tall trees of the forest. If Kiki was lost in thought and flying too low, her feet would ring the bells and the sound would bring her back to reality. Fortunately, they were ringing much less than they used to. Meanwhile, there was the sneeze medicine making, but Kiki didn't seem to be cut out for it.
She was impatient and found it difficult to grow the herbs, finally chop the leaves and roots, and slowly simmer them.
Will another type of magic disappear? Kokiri lamented.
In the olden days, witches could use all sorts of magic, but over the years, one type after another disappeared until even a genuine witch like Kokiri was left with only two abilities. Now her daughter hated one of them, so it was no wonder she was upset. But it feels so much better to fly through the sky than stir a pot.
Kiki didn't see what the issue was.
At these times, Okina would try to cheer Kokiri up. Well, we can't force it. Maybe someday lost magic will be relearned. Plus, she has her black cat, doesn't she?
Witches have long been accompanied by black cats. One could say that's another type of magic, too. When a witch has a baby girl, she searches for a black cat born around the same time and raises them together. As they grow, the cat and the girl learn to speak to each other in their own language. Kokiri used to have a cat named Mimi, and Kiki had one as well, a little black cat named Gigi. By the time the girl came of age, the cat would be a precious companion, and someone to turn to during good times and bad. Eventually, the girl would grow up and find a new companion to take the place of her cat. The cat would also find its own partner, and from then on, the pair would live separately. Kiki comes of age. After tea, Kokiri and Okina went out to run errands while Kiki and Gigi sat dreamily at the garden's edge.
I guess I should leave soon, Kiki said.
You should. You're not going to decide you don't want to be a witch this late in the game, are you?
Gigi asked, looking up at her. Oh, of course not. Then, the memory and thrill of her first time flying on a broom came rushing back. For most of her life, Kiki was brought up more or less like any normal girl. She knew that her mother was a witch and that she would have to decide for herself one day whether she wanted to be one too. Still, she never gave the decision serious thought. But a little while after she turned 10, she heard a friend of hers say,
"I'm going to follow in my mom's footsteps and become a hairdresser."
Kiki had a vague sense that Kokiri wanted her to follow in her footsteps, but she didn't wish to become a witch simply because of her mother.
"I'm going to be whatever I want," Kiki thought. "I'm going to decide for myself."
One day, Kokiri fashioned her daughter a little broom and asked, "Want to try flying?"
"Me? I can fly?"
"You're the daughter of a witch, so I should think so." She could tell her mother was trying to lure her into taking up the family tradition, but it was a rare chance, so she agreed to learn the basics. Following Kokiri, she shyly mounted her broom and kicked off the ground. Instantly, her body grew light. She was floating. "I'm flying!" she shouted in spite of herself. She was only about 10 feet above the rooftop, but it felt incredible. The sky even seemed a little bluer. And on top of that, a curiosity welled up inside her, lifting both her heart and body.
"I want to go higher, higher and higher. I wonder what I'll be able to see. What's it like up there? I need to know more."
It was love at first flight, so of course she decided to become a witch.
"It's in your blood," Kokiri said with delight, but Kiki told herself, "No, it's not just that. I decided for myself."
Suddenly, Kiki jumped up from the grass.
"Hey, Gigi, let's go check on my project, just for a minute, since Mom isn't here."
She jerked her chin toward the shed in the corner of the garden.
"Why are you keeping it a secret from Kokiri anyway?" Gigi moaned.
"'Cause she always makes such a big deal out of anything to do with coming of age, and she always has to have her say, which makes everything more complicated than it needs to be."
"Well, I understand that. Anyhow, you need to make sure it gets lots of sun so it can properly dry out."
"Only a little."
Okay, but don't bring it to bed again. If you sleep with it, it'll get moldy like last time."
"I know, I know. I need you to help me out, though. Pretty soon, it'll be just us two." As she spoke, she waded deftly through the waist-high herbs and angled her body into the space between the shed and the fence. Then she let out a happy yelp.
"Look!"
A long, thin broom hung from the eaves of the shed. It gleamed in the westering sun.
"If it's this beautiful, I think it'll be okay," she squealed.
"Yeah, it seems like the drying process went well this time."
Gigi looked up at her, wide-eyed.
"Hey, Kiki, why don't you try flying? The weather's nice."
"I can't do that," Kiki shook her head. "I'm not using it until the day I leave. It'll be here soon. I want everything to be brand new. My clothes, my shoes, and my broom, too. I want to be reborn. I'm sure Mom will say, 'You're from a long line of witches, so you need to value the old.' But I'm me. I'm a new witch."
"So how am I supposed to make myself new?" Gigi pouted, his whiskers bristling.
"You're fine. I'll brush your fur till it shines. You'll be all fresh."
"Hmm,"
Gigi sniffed.
Fresh cat, don't talk about it like you're going to cook me. You're not the only one coming of age, you know.
You're right, I'm sorry. Kiki held back a laugh and looked into Gigi's eyes. I wonder how it'll feel to leave.
I'll bet you cry.
Oh, no, I won't.
By the way, when are you finally planning to do it?
Gigi looked up at her again. Seems like we're ready, so we can pretty much leave any time. Want to make it the next night with a full moon?
What? The next one?
Yeah, in 5 more days. Doesn't it feel good to do something right when you decide?
This is going to be so much drama, as usual.
I'll tell Mom and Dad tonight. I wonder what kind of town we'll end up in, Gigi. Kiki looked into the distance with a new grown-up gleam in her eye.
I don't know. I'm a bit worried, to be honest, since you're so quick with your decisions.
Oh, I'm not worried at all. We can worry about things once they happen. Right now, I'm excited. It's like opening a present, she said breathlessly, and poked the broom. It swung back and forth as if it were nodding to her. After dinner that evening, Kiki stood with Gigi before Kokiri and Okino. You don't need to worry. I've decided when I'm going. Kokiri leaped out of her chair. Well, really? When will it be? The next night with a full moon. Kokiri ran her eyes over the calendar on the wall, bewildered. What? But that's only 5 days away. You should wait until the next one. Kiki frowned and scrunched her shoulders.
See, there you go again. You get mad if I dilly-dally, but then you complain when I actually decide.
She is right, dear. It's not quite fair, said Okino.
Sure, but there's so much to get ready. It's a lot of work for a mother, too.
Flustered, Kokiri turned red. Kiki leaned into her face, shook her hips, and sang,
Believe in your daughter. Believe. I'm already ready. Right, Gigi?
He twitched his tail in reply.
What?
Kokiri's jaw dropped, and she lowered her eyes.
What do you mean you're ready? What did you do?
I made a new broom. Gigi helped. Hold on, I'll go get it. Kiki opened the door and raced outside. Here it is. She was back in no time showing Kokiri and Okino the broom she'd hidden by the shed. Oh, nicely done. Okino smiled.
I soaked willow branches in the river and then left them in the sun. I did a good job, right, Mom?
Kiki swung the broom to show it off. Kokiri shook her head. It's a beautiful broom, but you can't use it.
Why not? I don't want to use that little broom I've had until now. Flying is the only magic thing I can do, so I at least want to fly on a nice new broom.
If flying is the only magic thing you can do, doesn't that make your broom that much more important? What will you do if you have trouble flying on something you've never ridden before? Your start is critical. Coming of age isn't so easy. Kokiri shook her head again and continued, We can only give you a little money, enough to eat for a year if you really keep your expenses down. After that, a witch has to survive on her magic. During this year, you need to figure out how to make a living, like how I prove myself useful to the townspeople by making medicine. Go with my broom. It's broken in, and you already know how to fly with it.
I don't want to. It's all dirty and black, like it's been used to clean a chimney, and the handle is so thick and heavy. It's clunky, don't you think, Gigi?
Gigi watched from her feet and let out an exaggerated purr.
See, Gigi agrees with me. He says a black cat riding that broom will get mistaken for a rain cloud, but on a willow broom, he'll look like a prince in a glass carriage.
I don't know what to do with the two of you, Kokiri exclaimed.
You're still a child, aren't you? Brooms aren't toys, you know. At some point, my broom will get too old, and then you can use whatever you like. By then, I'm sure you'll be a full-fledged witch.
Kokiri suddenly closed her eyes as if she was trying to think of something. Kiki pouted and tapped the broom on the floor.
But what about the broom I made?
I'll use it instead. No problem with that, is there? Kiki glanced at her broom for a few moments, but then looked up and said,
Fine, but let me pick my dress. I saw a pretty one on the shop on Main Street with a floral pattern. If I wear that, I'll look like a flying flower.
I'm sorry, but you can't do that either. Kokiri had a serious expression on her face again. These days, witches don't have to wear a pointy hat and a long cape, but the color of our clothes has always been the blackest black. That can't be changed. That made Kiki sulk even more.
It's so old-fashioned! A black witch with a black cat! Black, black, black!
Well, of course it's old-fashioned. We come from old witch blood. Besides, black never goes out of style. Leave it to me, I'll make one in a hurry.
This old blood thing again, Kiki mumbled, pouting.
Kiki, don't get too hung up on appearances. It's your heart that's important.
Mom, I know that. I'll handle my heart. No one can see that, though. Kiki turned her resigned face to Okino.
Dad, you'll give me a radio, won't you? I want to listen to music while I fly. I'd really like a red radio.
All right, got it. He nodded with a smile. Kokiri smiled, then abruptly turned to her daughter.
Okay, that's enough for tonight. Good night, Kiki.
And with her right hand, she used the hem of her apron to dab her eyes. Kiki lands in a big city. Every evening, the moon grew bigger and bigger until the night it was finally full. Kiki's coming-of-age day had arrived. That evening, when the sun started sinking in the west, Kiki put on her black dress her mother had made for her. She turned this way and that in the mirror, making it a whole production. Gigi, by her feet, wasn't about to be left out. He peeked into the mirror from the side, then stretched and curled his body. Soon, they were both astride Kokiri's broom, posing in profile.
Okay, you two, haven't you primped enough?
Kokiri called to them as she bustled around.
Have a look at the western sky. There's barely any sunset left.
Mom, can you make the skirt just a little shorter? Kiki asked, hiking it up and standing on her tiptoes.
Why? It looks good on you.
I think it would be cuter if you could actually see my feet.
This way is much more graceful. It's better to look mild-mannered. Of course, some people complain about witches no matter what you do. Now then, here's your lunch.
Kokiri patted Kiki's shoulder and set a little bundle down next to her.
I used herbs so it won't go bad as fast. Don't eat it all in one place.
I remember my mom did a great job making my coming-of-age lunch. She cast some spell on the herbs and the bread that kept it from going bad or even stale. It's a shame we don't know how to do that anymore.
That seems like the sort of thing that would be easy to pass on, though,
Okino chimed in, coming in from his study with a book in his hand.
I wonder why it disappeared. Maybe that's just the nature of magic?
I think it's strange that I'm a witch and even I don't know. Some say it's because there's no such thing as a completely dark night or a perfect silence anymore. If there's a light on or even a tiny noise, we get distracted and can't get our magic to work.
Certainly, compared to ancient times, it's gotten a lot brighter, Okino said. Nowadays, there's always a light on somewhere.
Yes, the world sure has changed, Kokiri nodded.
But Kiki, looking in the mirror, had a different idea.
You think that's why?
Kiki turned around with a dissatisfied frown.
I don't think it's the world's fault that magic has disappeared. Maybe people hold themselves back too much. Mom, aren't you always saying that witches must be quiet and modest? I hate the idea of living my life constantly worrying about what people will say. I'm going to do whatever I want.
Oh, that's quite a declaration.
Okino's eyes widened dramatically.
Listen, Kiki, Kokiri said. In the past, it wasn't just us witches. All sorts of people had mysterious powers. But most regular people connected these gifts to bad things in their head. They believed our powers would bring terrible luck.
That could be true, Okino nodded thoughtfully.
It was! You always heard about how witches made mold grow in fresh milk, but that was simply a way to make a special kind of cheese. And now look, today everyone eats that same cheese!
As she spoke, Kokiri looked at Kiki with concern.
Witches were able to survive in that sort of world because we forced a give-and-take relationship with everyone else. Sometimes we hold back, but we also help each other out, however we can. I think it was a good thing. Because of this, there are even people like your dad who research witches and fairies to gain a better understanding of us.
Was that a compliment? What an honor.
Okino jokingly bowed.
Oh my goodness, it's pitch dark outside.
Kokiri stood up and clapped her hands.
The moon will be out soon. We need to hurry up and eat. No more time for these complicated conversations.
Full moon nights are bright, Okino said, so they should be good for leaving on a journey. But according to my research, the data also shows a 50-50 chance of rain on days witches have come of age.
That's just the luck of the draw. Tonight seems like it'll be fine. The air is so clear. Kiki, are you really ready to go?
Skillfully evading Okino's grumbles, Kokiri began to bustle around the room again.
I hope you can find somewhere nice to live.
Okino looked Kiki in the eye.
But Kiki, you can't get impatient and settle without giving your choice proper thought, Kokiri called.
I know. All you guys do is worry.
It's not as if she's going to another planet, Okino said,
trying to cheer both Kokiri and Kiki up.
It's just a different town, and after a year, you can come back home for a celebratory visit.
Kokiri stood before Kiki again with a serious expression on her face.
Kiki,
I know I'm harping on this, but please choose your town carefully. Think twice about picking one that seems nice just because it's lively or has a lot of shops. Big cities are often full of busy people who don't have time to care about anyone else. And when you arrive, don't be shy. Make sure to smile. You have to gain people's trust.
I know, Mom. I'll be fine. Don't worry.
Kiki nodded repeatedly and then turned to Okino.
Hey, Dad, do you remember when you used to hold me up high? You would put your hands under my arms and lift me up and down. Can you do it one more time?
She looked down quickly, a little embarrassed.
Sure,
Okino replied with extra pep. He put his hands under her arms and tried to lift her.
Phew, you're heavy. When did you get so big? Let me try one more time.
He staggered a bit, but managed to raise her.
I'm up, but it tickles. Kiki squirmed and laughed.
Through the living room window, the light of the full moon poured over Mount Green in the east, just as they had expected. I guess I should get going. Kiki had planned on saying a proper goodbye, but all that came out was that simple line. She slung her bag over her shoulder and grabbed the broom that had been standing next to her. With her other hand, she picked up the red radio her father had brought for her. Then she looked at Gigi, who sat obediently at her feet.
Okay, say goodbye.
Gigi stood and looked up at Okino and Kokiri.
We're counting on you, Gigi, said Kokiri.
As usual, he twitched his tail in reply.
Well, Mom, I'll write you a letter as soon as I get there.
Yes, keep us posted.
If it doesn't go well, you can always come home, added Okino.
That's not happening, Kiki hurriedly replied.
Don't start going easy on her now,
Kokiri shot a soft glare at Okino. When Okino opened the door, voices shouting, Congrats! Came flying in. 10 townspeople were waiting at the gate.
Kiki was so surprised she didn't know what to say. You knew she was leaving tonight?
Kokiri asked hoarsely.
We can't let our little Kiki leave without saying goodbye. And it's something to celebrate.
Come back and ring the bells now and then.
Bring us stories.
Aw, thanks, everybody.
Kiki finally managed to squeeze that much out, then lifted Gigi to hide her crumpling face.
I'm glad the weather's good, Okino said quietly, looking up at the sky.
After exchanging goodbye after goodbye, Kiki hung her radio from the front of her broom, sat on the back, and jumped on. Once the broom was hovering, she turned around.
Take care, Mom,
she said to Kokiri from a few feet above. If she flew any closer, she knew they would both end up crying.
Make sure to look where you're going!
Kokiri's usual scolding voice sounded after her, followed by a burst of laughter from the townspeople. Kiki was relieved that her mom remained the same, even on this special occasion. After one final goodbye, she rocketed into the air. Gradually, everyone's waving hands below grew harder to see, and all the lights of the town twinkled like a starry night turned upside down. The full moon hung in the sky, watching over Kiki. Eventually, even the lights of the town faded, and all she could see below were mountains shaped like the dark backs of animals. And we'll stop there. Like I said, if you enjoyed this, please consider checking out the book, and I'll catch y'all later.